Danielle. I am here to work this fork into a design I've been asked to do by a sort of auntie-in-law, so to speak. She's my husband's aunt, and she gave me this crystal. I forget what she said it's called. It's really pretty. Anyway, she wanted rose quartz to go along with it in a bracelet. So I went on to good old eBay, and I found these really pretty pieces of rose quartz that are aura treated, so they have that kind of AB look about them. They're really small by comparison to this big piece of crystal, but I'm gonna sort of flank it, I think, like so. And as a sort of foundation for this, I thought I would use the old fork. It's one of these old cheapy forks. It actually belonged to my grandparents, but they gave it to me when I left home, and it's got one of these cute little 1950s kind of designs on it, so I thought I'd use it. And where the tines are, I thought would be a fun place to set these lovely stones with some silver wire, so that it's a little bit higher end. So I tried this on a dessert fork and tried to flatten out the part where you would put your food, and I tried to bend it this way around, and that was really hard, and it's obviously going to break, so I'm not going to do that. I'm going to try and follow the natural arch that's already there. And yeah, I got out the heavy duty tools for this one, which I will show you in a moment. I think these are crescent wrenches. If my dad were here, he'd be like, actually, it's something different. But anyway, something that can be adjusted. And I'm just gonna bend. There we go. Oh, that's looking good. Promising. So I'm literally just kind of pushing down. Okay, so that's looking promising. I like promise. Promise is good. Ugh. One thing I learned is you want to find the flimsiest fork you can, or spoon, or whatever you're going to do. Because if you use like a better quality stainless fork, it's hella difficult. I almost broke my fingers with the other fork that I showed you before. Keep on doing this until I get bent, as Bart Simpson would say. And I might bend the tines a little bit as well. I love that. They're like claws now. I will be making these more graceful, I promise. Alright, I'm going to carry on fighting with this, and I will be back. Okay, so here's where I'm at. I bent the tines, made little loops with them, just with my my round nose pliers, my jewelry ones. And I had a bracelet shape, but I wasn't happy with it because this here was kind of going, and it was just coming off of the wrist, kind of on the side of your wrist. It just looked like a weird hump. And I don't want that. So what I'm going to try to do is use my wrench and my pliers here all at once. I'm not used to using this kind of tools for this kind of stuff. So I'm trying to get the wrench really tight. Oh, that's better. Yeah. There, see? Ha! That might work. Well, let's take this off. So, now we've got a small diameter, but that's okay. Because this is bendy. I'm just kind of pinching and kind of pulling and pushing at the same time to try and make this side rounder, because it is kind of going straight and I don't want to do that. So I'm kind of trying to make the metal to make the metal curve, and kind of trying to make the underside stretch a little more. That doesn't make a lot of sense now that I verbalize it, but you know, if you know anything about how curves work, the underside is different than the outside, that's the word. So, let's see how this... I've been trying it on just to see if there's any kind of improvement. There is. So now, what needs to happen, it looks like it's sitting cleanly on my wrist now, which is good. But it falls to the side and makes that hump again because of the tines not being cinched down tight enough, and the tail here, the end of the fork, not being curved enough. So that's where that's at. Ugh. So that's a pretty easy fix, I think. So I'll pinch these down. Fork around my wrist. I like it. It took a fair bit of messing around, but I kind of like it. I like the flowers. And since my lovely auntie by marriage is a painter, it occurs to me that I can paint in here, because this is all stamped into the steel, so I can just take some paint and paint in that. That'll be awfully cute. And I might even do some painting on this fork to make it more interesting now that it's been manhandled. So that's where I'm at with this project. It took me a few minutes to get the bending part, but I think it'll work out. Okay, so I just grabbed some scrap tin foil because I never use palettes. I don't know why, I just have an aversion to them. I've got some paints here that I think will be wonderful. This is Liquitex Basics Light Blue Violet. I think that's going to be one of the flowers, or two of the flowers. I've got some Martha Stewart Pearl Tiger Lily. It's a nice orange. And it's a really, really cute pearl finish. Only need a teeny bit of this. Beach glass in satin. I'm going to use this as my green because it's kind of a 60s, 50s, 60s kind of green. There they are. And yellow. It's called, of course, it's Martha Stewart, so it's got a fancy name, chamomile. And it's high gloss. I'm really digging these Martha Stewart paints. They are multi-surface, so you can, I've painted glass with them, and it sticks. It's awesome. So I think what I'm going to do is use my old toothpick and try and make a green. We'll see how it goes. Because as we know, yellow and blue make green. This is going to be an interesting green because this is more of a... This is an interesting choice for green. There, blue. There we go. See? I hope you can see all this. Yeah, that's really cool. I'm going to stick with that. So I'm going to paint with this toothpick. I paint with all kinds of crazy things. There we go. And these are little recessed areas that I'm covering in paint. There. So I'm literally just kind of putting the paint in there and just dragging it around. Because you really don't need very much. Okay, so I'm going to carry on in such a fashion, and I will be back when it's done, and I'll show you how I did it. Hallelujah. Okay, so here is the painted floral motif on this fork, and I also went around the edges with my paints. And my toothpicks, and just kind of let the paint do what it wanted to as far as mixing, and that's it. So I'm gonna let it dry. I didn't put any paint on the underside that'll touch your skin. So what I've done is I've decided to use these coils that I made with the end of the tines to my advantage. I've just been kind of threading the wire through each loop just to give us something like a foundation, that the wire is in place and it won't want to move, and I'll be able to connect the stones more securely to... I'll just weave in between the tines as best I can. I think that'll work. I think. My imagination and my mind says, yeah, that'll work. But you never know until you try. So the loop without the stone because I don't want to break it. So I waited an awful long time to get this rose quartz, and I am not going to break any. God damn it. So, there. I just went underneath the first tine. And through the loop. Yeah, because this metal is soft, it should be amenable to me moving it around after I make all these loops and stick the rose quartz in. So I'm going to keep looping in this fashion and we'll see what happens. Okay, I am back with 3 pieces of rose quartz strung onto your woven, kind of onto the fork. It worked. So here's the sort of method I devised for doing this. Come out this side of your fork, or the other side if you're left-handed, and do a loop around your piece of crystal or stone, and then go under the first tine of the fork, like so. And don't get stuck on all your tools. Alright, now, these little kinks are inevitable, so I'm gonna just try and work that out. As best you can. It goes in little stages. You kind of have to finesse this into place. It took me a few minutes to get those little ones to sit on there and be stable. So don't be discouraged. Just like any wire wrapping, it's tricky at first. There. I've got the beginning of a link here. It's tricky with these irregular kind of crystals because they vary so much in size, which is part of their charm, but at the same time, when working with them, you have to be really careful. So I'm going to go through underneath the loop I made. Pull this way. Like so. And then what I did is I just went straight across the fork, like that. And then wrapped around the other side. And up through the tines there, so that now you've got kind of like an anchor, like a foundation to work with. It's like creating a thread bridge sort of with brick stitching, if you want to think of it in those terms. So hold your stone firmly, because it will want to fall out at this point. Go down through here, like so. And I'm going to come back up through the next tine. not get caught on any. Do I have a pinch there? Oh, wire. You're so inarticulate sometimes. There we go. Then I'm going to go over the thread bridge and underneath through the next tine, like that. Down, pull. Sometimes you have to push. What the heck happened there? Wait. There. So you can go back over this as many times as you like. Oops, wrapped around you. There we go. Now, to tighten this, what I've been doing is pulling tight at the end and then just taking some pliers and just kind of bending the wire to snug it up. And that'll make your stone want to stay better. And just keep doing that until it won't move anymore. Within reason. I mean, you can't do it too tightly, otherwise you'll break it, but you know what I mean. Like, that's pretty darn good right there. And then you're all back out on this side again. So here we are. I got interrupted during my last little clip of video shooting. My husband just got an articling position because he just finished his program for his JD, so that's really exciting. And that is what I've been doing rather than working on this lately. So here's the there we go. Four affixed crystals. And I'll do a small one just so that you have a sense of what it's like on a smaller scale. I've gone under like this. Doot doot. I'm coming up and gonna go down through the tine like so. And then you can just pull down gently, and you'll have a loop around your smaller crystal. Ta-da! Now, I like to just swing around the side, come up and over. So, swing around, up and over, around the side. And then come up through here. Bend up. Oops. Pesky kinks. Now I'm up and through, and I'm going to go over top of that little thread bridge, or metal bridge, I guess it's called in this case, that I made. There we are. So now it's somewhat stabilized. And I'll come up through the middle. The middle tine. Well, the middle void, anyway. I don't know what the proper nomenclature is. And then down, like so, through the, over the bridge. Through this last one again, just for symmetry's sake, we'll make four wraps over that little bridge, down, pull, there, and now just tighten things up with my pliers here. You can use your straight pliers. I'm just using these chain nose ones because they're handier. So there you have it. I've got two more little crystals to affix, and I will be back when I'm done and I will show you the end result. Ta-da! Okay, so I lied about showing you the finished piece because I ran out of space with the tines. As you can see, they are fully encased in crystal. So what I had to do was sort of revert to that idea I had at the very beginning of wrapping around here. To create a thread bridge. I'm such a weaver. Of metal bridge to support the last crystal and give me something to wrap around to stabilize it, because I don't have those voids anymore. So that's what I'm gonna attempt to do. I'm glad that idea wasn't a total waste. Come on. It can be tricky to fit these sometimes. There. So I wrapped around the fork right here a couple of times just to give me something to lash onto. Well, that's not surrounding that very well at all. Come on. Nope. Okay, I'm gonna mess with this for a while. You don't need to see me messing.
Alrighty, everybody. Check it out. I finished it. I got all of the crystals on. I finished the thread bridge down here at the beginning of the fork, spoony part of the fork where you would put your food. Yeah, that technique ended up working out just fine. And I recommend at the end, when you've got all of your crystals or stones or whatever you're using affixed with your wire, just go over everything again with your pliers, because as you loop things along, previous wraps will, you know, loosen up a bit again on you. So just once you're done, yeah, just go over everything one more time and squish down your ends and tuck them in. I recommend tucking them in on the surface here where you can and get away with it. I wouldn't do it on the underside that's going to touch people's wrists, because you really don't want any cuts or unfortunateness to have to have to happen. So, when they mean multi-surface, they actually mean it at Martha Stewart Omni Media, or whatever it is. So, I hope that Auntie Marianne likes this. That's why I've been calling it the Marianne Bracelet. And I hope you like it too. Thanks for watching. Stay happy, as TC Beads would say. And I will see you in the future. Bye-bye. Sweeter than a honeybee, yeah, baby, been sweet on me. Sweeter than a honeybee, yeah, my queen bee. Oh, she love me to my soul. Ooh, love me to my soul.